deep in your eyes. I touch on you more and more every time. When you leave, I'm begging you not to go. Call your name 2-3 times in a row. So that was Crazy in Love, of course, which you sang with a certain gentleman. Yes. Mr. JZ, as we call him in Great Britain. JZ. Now, I sat opposite your husband at a dinner, and I didn't know what to expect. You know, you hear sort of ferocious rap star coming to town, everyone battens down the hatches. In walks this guy, immaculately dressed. I mean, immaculate. Incredibly charming, friendly, easy to talk to, funny, very, very funny. We had 2 or 3 hours just talking about life and the universe, a little bit about you and stuff. And I was really impressed with him. And I don't say that just to make you feel good. I actually was genuinely struck by, you know, he's not just a successful singer or a good businessman. He's a good man, it struck me. You could have had your pick of any guy. What was it about JZ? That's the last time I'm calling him that, but it gets me a free laugh in America.
Oh, I feel the same way you feel. And Jay and I have kind of made a decision that we want to be known for our music and you know, not our relationships or scandals. And it's hard because sometimes it's like, okay, I can't talk about him, but he's amazing.
He's amazing.
And I agree with all of the things that
occasionally
you
just better sit back and go, you know what? My husband's a pretty cool guy.
Yeah, he is.
And he is a pretty cool guy.
He really is.
He was there last night supporting you.
Yes.
He's abandoned you with me to go to the tennis, which I'm personally quite pleased about.
I'm not. No, I'm happy to be here with you.
when you sing a song like Crazy in Love, mm-hmm. how many times have you been crazily in love in your life?
Not many. Not many at all.
And then you meet this guy.
Yeah.
And that's it. Bang.
I definitely had a very natural friendship and connection with him. And I mean, we've been together for a very long time and I'm just very happy.
What does love mean to you? Proper love.
Well, you know, love is the foundation of everything. Everything I do. It's inspired. My music is inspired by love and from my family, from my husband, from my sisters. And it gives me the security and the confidence that you see on the stage.
And it is, I mean, most people say you have to have had your heart broken to sing with real emotion. Mm. I don't get the sense that you ever have.
I've had my life experiences, definitely. I mean, I haven't had this perfect, flawless life. And any relationship, you go through issues and you have to learn each other and you grow and you have painful moments. And I feel like, you know, a lot of my life experiences I used in this album, there's a way that I'm singing that's very different. And I think I had an epiphany when I did Cadillac Records, when I played Etta James, because for the first time I had to sing from a different place. Mm. She was addicted to heroin and I've never done any drugs. So I had to use, you know, the most painful emotions and memories of my life and sing from that place.
Let's just hold and watch a clip from that, okay. Because it was an incredible performance.
Thank you.
And we'll talk about it after this.
You wouldn't even begin to know my problems, baby.
Hey, let me.
My mother was a whore. And that fat motherfucker just looked me in my face and he didn't see himself. He didn't see his little girl.
I mean, a really visceral, raw performance that. And it surprised a lot of people. A lot of your critics watched it and were like, whoa, okay. She's not as simple in terms of her performing as we think she is. There was a real depth there. That must have been satisfying to you.
It was very satisfying. And I worked really, really hard. So, you know, it felt good to know that it was appreciated. And even if it wasn't, it was such growth for me as a human being and as an artist. And it made me want to take more risks in my career. It made me a lot braver. And to have the freedom to kind of let go of all ego and not care about what I look like or fitting into a pop star box. It just was really liberating to me.
Do you like the acting?
I do.
Do you like the pace of it? I would imagine with singers, when you get on stage, you know, wham, bam, it's all over in 2 hours.
Yeah.
And you get all the energy out and you go and have a drink, whatever you want to do. When you're acting, you're always sitting around waiting, hundreds of people watching you.
I don't like that as much, but I do like the stability. I like being able to go to the same place every night and your call time is around the same every morning and you're around the same people for 6 months and you don't have to travel 100 places. So you kind of build a family relationship. And because I've been touring since I was 13, that is something I haven't had in my life.
How do you like doing those love scenes?
I don't like them.
Do you not?
No. They're uncomfortable. But after maybe...
Even if it's like Idris Elba, as you,
no,
as you had that time.
No, it's uncomfortable.
I mean, he's a good-looking guy.
He is, but, you know, it's weird because, you know, I didn't grow up acting. So I've done six or seven movies, which I've done kind of some romantic scenes in maybe three. So it's still new to me. But I realized that, you know, it's a part of it. And after a few times... kind of becomes choreography, so it gets a little easier.
Must be uncomfortable. I couldn't do it.
It's strange. It is. I mean, actors don't say that, but I feel that it's strange.
We're going to have a little break. When we come back, I want to talk to you about brand Beyoncé.
Okay.
What it is and how you keep it at the top. Now, Beyoncé, it just wouldn't be right for you to be in my hometown of London and I don't introduce you to a classic English tea.
I am very happy.
Because I know that despite your very svelte physique, that occasionally you do have lapses and you have these mad eating days, right?
I do. And
pizzas,
I missed it yesterday.
Fries, it all goes swilling in.
Yes.
You couldn't have it yesterday because of Glastonbury.
Yes.
You now have a piping hot cup of English tea.
Uh-huh.
Then what you need, especially on a hot summer's day like this, is a scone. I'm going to prepare one for you.
Okay, and these are, what is this pronounced?
Well, it's called a scone, or if you're really pretentious, you can call it a scone.
Okay,
which is what people who think they're members of the royal family or ought to be call them scones.
Okay.
So you take some cream. It's about as fattening as it can possibly get this.
It looks delicious.
Take a bit of fattening cream. You take some jam mm-hmm. like this. Slop it all on.
Mm-hmm.
And you put it together, and this is an old-fashioned... And it basically gives you a heart attack in about 5 minutes. But on behalf of Great
Thank
Britain,
you very much.
There is your first ever scone.
Okay, I'm going to try it. Okay, do I just go away?
Just go for it.
Okay. Mmm.
Now, how good is that? Seriously.
Delicious. I love it.
Seriously. It's,
it's
the,
very
it's the
good.
Tastiest thing you're ever going
like
to eat.
It's like a Popeye's chicken biscuit. My favorite. I know I'm supposed to be proper. I'm having tea.
It's pretty delicious. Cool, isn't it?
I love
isn't
it.
Isn't it nice?
Mm-hmm. The cream is so great.
You've spoken quite honestly and openly about occasionally having slight weight problems in your life. How have you dealt with them? And what advice do you give your female fans in particular who may be going through that period in their lives?
Well, I have found my personal goal, my ideal weight for myself, and I try to stick with that. You can't let anyone tell you what, you know, your best is. You know what your best is. And I work at it. You know, you can have whatever you want. It just takes work.
You're 29 years old.
Yes.
And in September, the
30.
Looming, dooming big 3-0 is
yes.
emerging in your life. You're pretending to be very, very thrilled about this.
No,
are you?
I am absolutely serious. I can't wait because 29 is very strange. You're still in your 20s, but you feel like you're supposed to be 30. And I feel like a woman. I feel, you know, like I'm very aware of who I am. And I feel great. And I feel like 30 is the ideal age because you're mature enough to know who you are and to have your boundaries and your standards and not be afraid of too polite, but you're young enough to be a young woman. I'm so looking forward to it.
You see, when I hear you speak like this, in this mature, sensible, rational way.
It's the truth.
Yeah, but it's beginning to sound a bit like your mother, which makes me think.
No.
You're now heading to the right kind of time in your life.
I'm turning into my mom.
No, I didn't mean that.
You're trying to say I need to have a baby.
I didn't even ask the question.
Okay. I always said I would have a baby at 30.
I know you did.
I'm 29.
Exactly.
But I also said I was going to retire at 30. So I don't know.
So it could be a big year.
Who knows? I'm not retiring.
Can we expect the little patter of little Beyoncé and Jay-Z's?
You know, only God knows. Only God knows.
Would you mind asking him to tell me?
I will have a conversation. I whisper, but you can't tell anybody else.
Now, we're going to go off in a moment to do a very exciting thing involving your new album. But before we go, if I could ask you to replay the greatest moment of your life, the moment, the 5 minutes maybe, that you would replay if you had the chance, what would it be?
Oh, that's a tough one.
So far?
I talked about, I think, two of the highlights, which is Glastonbury and performing for the president.
I was kind of hoping that you were going to say tea and scones
but
with
that's because you didn't
you,
give
Piers?
Me a chance. You just...
So for the record,
you ruined
the greatest
it.
Moment
it
of your life.
Absolutely speaking to you today, Mr. Morgan.
Beyoncé?
Yes.
I couldn't have asked for more.